in-person worshipers, as well as our friends worshiping with us online. I have one correction to our bulletin today. The flowers on the altar are provided by Gary and Cheryl G. This afternoon at 3 o'clock, we will hold our Blue Christmas service. This service is certainly open to anyone, but especially for those who are experiencing a loss of any kind, or just find Christmas to be a difficult time of year. You may join us in person or online. This year's Christmas Eve service will be held at 7 p.m., again, in person and online. Those of you who are wishing to share an offering today may do so in person out in the trays outside of the sanctuary door or online through the church website.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to worship today. Our first hymn is What Child Is This? It's number 184 in the hymnals if you wish to sing along. It's also a very, very old European melody, just like our prelude, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. So if you would please rise and join me in singing along with What Child Is This?
What child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping? Whom angels greet with anthems sweet while shepherds watch are keeping?
Come, O long-expected Jesus, born to set your people free. From our fears and sins release us, Christ in whom our rest shall be. Long ago the people were given a sign of God's presence. Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. God's promise to us remains sure and true. God's anointed one will soon walk among us to lighten our darkness, to restore the joy of our salvation, to save us from our sins. Four lights now shine in spite of our despair. Jesus is coming soon.
Will you pray? mystery. You help us accept your gifts of grace, even when we do not understand them. You plant a stubborn hope deep in our hearts, even when we feel afraid. We come to worship again this day, ready to embrace the Christ child. When Jesus is birthed anew in our lives through faith. Thank you for teaching us your ways, giving us your hope, and inviting us to receive, embody, and carry this child to the world. Amen.
Good morning to our youngest Christians. I'm Mr. Cruz, and I'm very happy to be with you here this morning. And so is my good companion, Mr. Oakley, here. Merry Christmas to everybody. There was an important announcement over 2,000 years ago. And to this day, it remains the most important announcement the world has ever known. From the book of Luke, we learn that an angel named Gabriel visited a young girl named Mary and said to her, "Be happy, you highly favored one. God is with you." Would you be frightened if you had a visit from an angel? I would. And it seems that Mary was a little frightened and confused as well, because she didn't know exactly what was happening. When we don't know exactly what's happening, it can be a little confusing and sometimes frightening. Can you remember a time when you felt frightened or confused? Perhaps it was the first day of school and you didn't know exactly what was going to happen or take place. Or your first day at camp, and you didn't know if you would make any friends. Sometimes when you're frightened or confused, it can be helpful when someone, like a parent or a teacher, explains to you what you can expect or what might happen. And as you become more familiar with your situation, you begin to feel more comfortable. And that's how it was for Mary. The angel kept talking to her and said, "Don't be afraid. You have found favor with God." And the angel explained to her that she would have a baby and his name would be Jesus, and that he would be the Son of God, and that his kingdom would last forever. Now, although Mary was frightened and confused, she trusted God, and she told the angel, "I am a servant of the Lord. Let it happen to me according to your words." Now, here's the important message from our Bible story this morning. Whenever you feel frightened or confused, always remember that God loves you, just as he loved Mary. And just like the angel told Mary that God was with her, know that God is with you as well. Would you bow your heads as I say a prayer? Heavenly Father, thank you for loving us and for being for us. Help us to trust in you and to understand that with you, nothing is impossible. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Here. years upon the death of Brenda's father, Delbert Isley. He was 92. And also, will you remember Karen Hansen's cousin, Marge Burke, who was ill? Marge is 100. Please remember Marge in your prayers, too. As we pray today and in the days ahead, I thought I would share with you a Christmas letter that I received just a couple of days ago. And we received this letter from friends of ours. Their names are Sarah and Juan, and they live in St. Louis. And I've known Sarah since we were in a high school youth group together, so that goes back over 45 years. And as I read this letter, I felt strongly that I wanted to share it with you. And I think it relates to many of the things that we've been experiencing and things that we can pray for and have been praying about, and also certainly connects with our Blue Christmas service this afternoon. So it's not terribly lengthy, but I think you'll find it worth your time. She writes, I think it was from Sarah, right? First of all, we are so thankful for each of you. You are very important to our family. This is not your average Christmas letter. If we were to sum up 2021 in one word, we choose the word lament. Conversations around grief and suffering are all over the media, and more importantly, have been occurring more and more frequently in letters, cards, texts, phone calls, and our day-to-day interactions. These conversations echo the back-and-forth waves and the up-and-down shape of ongoing trauma. There must be some sort of framework for lamenting that can carry us along the continuum of the pandemic, racial injustices, division, loss of life, loss of relationships, illness, sadness, and grief, in order that our sorrow is kept from hemorrhaging all over the place. We put together a list of some suggestions each of you has reminded us of. Gifted to us over the year. Number one, celebrations of birthdays, holidays, and events that all mark important pauses for memories to flow. Number two, reading materials and written words that speak pauses of meditations for what ifs and woulds to fill. Number three, music, art, and theater that move us into rhythms and shadows for emotions of a collective experience or escape. Number five, relationships that share time for hearing our own pain and sorrow while listening to another's story. Oh, I skipped number four. Number four is exercise and movement that open up new perspectives and renewed abilities. And number six, ways to serve others that help raise the voices of the less privileged and underserved. Well, Jeremiah was a bullfrog, and in the book of Lamentations, he speaks for and about his people's distress as well as his personal sorrow. In the middle of the book, there is a glimmer of hope, much like the pink candle that stands among the purple candles in the Advent. The book continues with Jeremiah no longer speaking. Instead, a single voice appears to express more sorrow and is followed by the voice of the entire community lamenting in solidarity. Maybe the book shows us a framework that holds space for listening to one another and allowing a way for our own laments to intertwine into the story being expressed. This might create an opportunity to see the beauty in one another through our tears and accept each other into a community of interwoven laments. In the expression of lamenting as a community, there can be surrender to love one another. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Love, Sarah. Not the typical Christmas letter that I receive or we receive, but one I hope will be helpful for you. And loving God, Holy Spirit, Creator, at the beginning you hovered over the waters, you breathed life into all creatures. Without you, every living creature dies and returns to nothing. But you come to us, Holy Spirit, you comfort us. By you, we are born again as children of God. You make us living temples of your presence. You pray within us with prayers too deep for words. You come to us as a Holy Spirit. You are our Lord and giver of life. You are light. You bring us light. You are goodness and the source of all goodness. You sanctify and breathe life into the whole body of your church. You dwell in each one of its members and will one day give new life to our mortal bodies when they have passed from this life. O God of joy and jubilee, you fill our hearts with the light of your promise. You enter our lives as softly and quietly as a child, so we might learn to love you in simplicity and purity of heart. We are your people. We are ready for the darkness to be over. We are ready for your light to dawn. We are ready for Christ, the child and the Savior, to enter into our hearts and into our lives. We hear your call. We seek to follow. We ask only that you would provide for us all that we need. We give you permission, O God, to come into our lives, to fill us with your Spirit, to embody Christ within us, and to help us to share it and him with others. We pray all these things in his name, and we pray the prayer he taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, the amazing gift of the one who fully embodied God's presence with us, who fully embodied God's intention for humanity. This amazing gift of Jesus to us prompts us to make a grateful response. In Jesus Christ, we know a hope that is certain, and we have a love that will not let through our offering, we may share this love in our community and to the ends of the earth. May we make an offering to God for God's gracious purposes. Thank you. Once more, will you pray with me? God, I am so grateful that I have ears to hear beautiful music with. I am so grateful for all the gifts that you give to us. You shower us with your goodness every day, O God, and now with grateful hearts we bring you these gifts. Will you transform them into more gifts, outpourings of peace and justice, to reconcile all peoples to one another and to you. Amen. Thank you.
This morning's scripture reading is taken from the first chapter of Luke, verses 26 through 38. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be, Mary?" asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be barren is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." And the angel left her.
Sometimes I listen to the music here, and I think, I don't know that I can speak. Thank you, Kathy and Linda. I don't have words to express the feeling that I have with that music. But thank you, God. Maybe it will help that I'm actually going to read something. I came across this some years ago and kept it. I don't know who originally wrote this, but it has to do with, can you imagine if you were, imagine an outsider coming to our country and you knew nothing about our country and you knew nothing about Christmas. And this person wrote this with that in mind. A foreign exchange student from a non-Christian country sent this email home. "They have this most amazing festival here. It's all about a little boy with a drum. And he's been born in a sleigh. In some straw, right next to some chestnuts roasting in an open fire. Yes, it is all a bit dangerous, but it's okay, because he is guarded by this enormous fat man in a red suit named Round John Virgin, standing by a tree with a partridge in it, drinking something called wassail. No, I'm not exactly sure what this is, and nobody here can tell me, but there's a lady kneeling nearby with a light over her head, and a couple of sheep, and a donkey, and camels, and this really strange deer with a red electric nose, and a dog sleeping on top of a doghouse, while a crotchety old man is hoisting this crippled boy on his shoulder, who is hanging on to a turkey by the neck and shouting, 'God bless us, everyone.'" Yeah, the little boy says that and not the turkey. "Well, anyway, after they sing for a while, they take all these packages and wrap them up in paper, which they then take right off again. And the little kids play with the paper and not the new toys. The older kids exclaim, 'Is that all there is?' And the fathers sit in front of the TV while the mothers collapse into a chair, and the festival concludes some 60 days later with an observance called Visa Card Day. It is then that everybody becomes really serious, very religious, and quite worshipful as millions of people open envelopes and shout at the top of their voices, "My Lord!" Yeah, it really is a lot of fun. So Christmas, from the perspective of someone who knows nothing about Christmas but is here watching us observe Christmas, so it is helpful on this fourth and final Sunday in Advent to be reminded by our text of what it's really all about. It's really all about the birth of Jesus of Nazareth. And the reason we tell the story of the birth of Jesus of Nazareth, scholars say it was probably the last of the stories of Jesus really to be put down. The reason we tell these stories is because through Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, his followers came to believe that God was with us. God was with us, reconciling the world to himself. And so in this child is God. As Emmanuel says, God with us. That's what Emmanuel means. So that's what the season is really about. The season is really about God coming into our world in the form of a baby. And there is no other story like that. The story is intended to teach ideas about God and about the way that God has come into our world and is with us. One thing it tells us is that God does have a plan, that God has a purpose, that the birth of Jesus is the next step in God's glorious plan to save us, and that God is working our world through Jesus. This is the final sermon in the series we've been calling The Christmas Spirit. We talked about the Holy Spirit, and we know that the Holy Spirit is a part of this story. It says that the Holy Spirit will overshadow Mary. Will come upon her. And those words in the original Greek have nothing to do with sexual relations. But they are meant to communicate that this child to be born is God. But not just God, but also born of a woman. A child like us. A human like us. And for that to happen, as part of God's great work, as part of God's great purpose, for that to happen, Mary must give her permission. Now I know there's not the formal please and thank yous and will yous and all that sort of in the story, but if you read the story, at least as I read it, the last verse is absolutely crucial. Absolutely crucial, where Mary says, "Let it be done unto me. I am a handmaid to the Lord." And so, we discover in this story unlike any other that God's coming into the world to save us is through the permission of this teenage girl. Unlike any other story, some people will compare compare these stories to other myths and fables of God's being unlike any other story. The Holy Spirit overshadows nothing of a sexual relation, nothing being coerced or compelled. Rather, this girl must give the permission. That, to me, is absolutely extraordinary, but it is consistent with how God works in our lives. God, we understand through this story, does have a purpose. God is working out his plan of salvation. And God comes into the world to save us. And in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, we see that God always works through our permission. Someone has said, without God, we cannot. If that's a little daunting, in an age and time where so much news is bleak, I often wonder where young people today look for hope. Where do they look for hope for our future? Well, as Christian people, our hope is not founded on something that might happen someday in the future. Our hope is not based upon us looking forward to an event. Our hope is rooted in something that has already happened. It is based firmly in history. God has come into the world in Jesus. And in his life, death, and resurrection, a new age has begun. That is the foundation of our hope. Not just at Christmas time, but 365 days out of the year. Our hope is rooted in what God has already done for us. And God continues to work through people in a way similar to the way God worked through Mary. Now, of course, this story is certainly, of all stories, completely singular. But in our own way and in our own time, through the gift of the Holy Spirit, God gives us an opportunity to receive Christ, to embody Christ to the world, and to present Christ. That's what Mary is doing. That's why she's called the very first Christian. She is the first person in history to say yes to Christ. And if you follow the story, you'll see that she's the only character in the story that is with Jesus from the very beginning all the way to the cross. Yes, she's there at the foot of the cross. But we can do something of the same. We can receive Christ, embody Christ to the best of our own ability, and share Christ with the world. But God seeks, wants, and waits for our permission. Now, one of the things that I notice about people and about myself is the way I go about obtaining things that I want. And there's a variety of options out there. Again, I noticed this about myself. One is to go forward with the philosophy. I'm sure you've heard it. It's easier to ask for forgiveness than permission. You just go ahead and do it, counting on the fact that whatever the repercussions will be, they'll be at least worth the fact they weigh or outweigh the gain of you going ahead and doing it. That's one way to go about obtaining what you want. Another way is, well, just to manipulate. you know, or to cajole, or to plead, or to beg, or to threaten, anything other than asking for it. Just ask him directly. Will you fill in the blank? And of course, one reason I avoid doing that sometimes is because I'm afraid that the person will say no. And then I'm up against, you know, up against it. But when we ask for permission, we honor it. We respect it. We put value on it. We see that this person has a right. They're a person. They have a choice. And I want you all to know that you have the right to choose. You have the right to choose. God has given you that right, and God Himself respects that right. And so you can say yes, and you can say no. The choice is yours. It's hard sometimes to live with a no, but God does it every day. Some people wonder, why does the kingdom take so long to come? Jesus promised it. We inaugurated this age. He said He's going to come back. We believe He's been raised from the dead. He must come back. That's our hope for the future. He will come back and establish peace and justice. And I don't know. I can't give you the timetable. But it seems to me, related to what we're talking about, God works through people who give their permission. Which is really a resounding affirmation of at least some of us, because the promise that He's going to return is based upon or predicated upon the idea that we know there's always going to be enough people who will say, "Yes, Lord, let it be done unto me as You would have it done." There's a Christmas list for you. You want your name on that list? People who would say, "Yes, God, I give You permission to use me. I give You permission to take my life and use it to bear Christ to the world." Now, in Mary's case, just a brief reminder for those of you who may not be familiar with the time and the age, the spirit of the time. You see, she was considered engaged to be married at this time. In that culture, the way it worked was, it was an arranged marriage. The parents would come together. They would sign a document, and they would say, "This girl, usually 13, 14 years old, is going to be married to this guy, usually a little bit older, and that's going to take place in a year from now." See, why did met with the guy a couple, three times? They've probably never been alone together. So, small culture, society very concerned with just existing, so very strong boundaries around marriages and relationships and these kinds of agreements. And they were considered married, even though they had not had the ceremony yet where the husband came to her home. And there was a procession across town, and he took her back to this house, and had the big ceremony and all that. But if she was discovered to be with child before the actual marriage, well, the penalty was very serious. Actually, it Testament prescribed stoning. And whatever you make of this story that we've just read from Luke chapter 1, here is a woman, a young girl, really, who is saying to God, "Yes, I give you permission to do this to me. Let it be done." You know, I think one of the things we struggle with in our own lives, at least I'm speaking for myself, is just the permission I give to myself. You know, permission to make mistakes, permission to try something and fail, you know, permission to feel happy, permission to take a break, permission to be angry, permission to say what I think or feel, permission, permission. We have these rules. That's what permission is about, right? Don't break the rules. Very powerful, powerful. Girl who seems to be breaking all the rules, the things that are permitted by society, by saying yes to God. So much of my relationship with God is founded upon selfish motives. What can God do for me? What do I get out of this for God? What am I going to benefit? What is this going to, you know, in the end, is this going to help me? Is this going to make me a happier person? Is this going to protect my family? Is this going to make me better? I don't know. What about saying yes? God, I give you permission. I give you permission. So here we are 2,000 years later, celebrating this grand event that may look strange to people who don't know anything about it. Really, the focus is on God's presence. And as Christian people, we are taught that this Holy Spirit that overshadowed Mary and brought this child into this world, this child is God and also one of us. This Holy Spirit is still at work in our lives today, seeking,
God's peace go with you into the worlds and places in which you live. You've been nurtured in this time of gathering. Will you be faithful in the time apart? Will you say yes to God willingly, freely? Will you? The choice is yours. But you can't choose to love and serve each other in the name of God, who calls us to love and serve one another. And the blessing of God, who is our Creator, Redeemer, and Savior,